Hello, everyone, and welcome back to our study through 2 Peter. I'm so glad that you have joined us today. Let's go ahead and look at our passage of Scripture. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read the passage of Scripture, and then we're going to, I'm going to introduce some thoughts to you as we work our way through the Scriptures, okay? Then it'll make some more sense to you, okay? But let's read it first and see what the Word of God says. So, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 12 through 21. It says this: "Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities." Now, if you don't know what the qualities Peter's talking about, you need to go back and you need to read verses 6 through 8. And that you'll understand some of the qualities he's talking about there. And he says, "I remind you of these qualities, though you know them and are established in the truth that you have. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder. Since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made it clear to me, and I will make every effort so that after my departure you may be able at any time to recall these things. For we did not follow," and this is an important verse right here, verse 16, "for we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." Verse 17, it says, "For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased,' we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven. For we were with him on the holy mountain, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." Now I just want to introduce to you a big idea that you need to understand through as you read through this. You may read through this and you say, man, Peter talks about, he refers to the qualities mentioned in the last teaching that we talked about. He talks about seeing Jesus glorified in the transfiguration. He talks about the Word of God and talking about basically the inspiration of Scripture, how people came about writing the Word of God. And so you say, what do all these things have in common? So what you need to understand, and this is why I pointed out verse 16, is Peter is trying to help the church that is his audience that's receiving this letter. He's trying to remind them and to affirm the gospel of Jesus. He's trying to remind his audience the true way of salvation. Because in order to be found faithful, they have to stand firm in the gospel. If they want to be found faithful when the Lord returns, then that's the whole theme of 2 Peter, is to be found faithful, serving God and standing firm. If they are to stand firm and to be found faithful, then they need to make sure their foundation of the gospel is right and that they're holding fast to it. So how does he affirm the gospel? How does he encourage them to be established in their faith? How does he do that? We obviously see that in verse 16 that there were false teachers that were trying to creep in their way into the church so they could lead the church astray. These men were wolves in sheep's clothing, as the Bible says. They were evil men who wanted to lead people astray to believe wrong things about Jesus, to believe wrong things about the gospel. And so Peter is going to give them, the audience, the church, he's going to give them three things that they need to hold fast to. He's going to give them three reasons, three witnesses, three testimonies, as we'll see, that are three reasons, like basically three testimonies as to why they should hold fast to the gospel. So the first one is found in verses 12 through 15. And this is why I said you need to know what the qualities are that he mentions here. He says, "Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities, though you know them," right, "and are established in the truth that you have," excuse me, Verse 13, I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon. And as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me, and I will make every effort so that after my departure you may be able at any time to recall these things. The Peter gives us the first testimony, the first witness as to what the true gospel message is. And he says the first truth, the first testimony is a changed life. See, he reminds us of the fact that the church has been changed by the gospel. He says, don't depart from the gospel message. Don't change your understanding of what I've taught you and what the apostles have taught you. The gospel that we taught you is what the true gospel is. Don't go looking for a new gospel or new false teaching or mythology or all these other religions. He says, you want to know that the gospel's true? Look at your own life. He says, you have been changed by this gospel. You know that it is true, that it's powerful, it works, that the gospel can change your life. So he says, you want to know what the first proof of the fact that the gospel is true and that the gospel we taught you is true? He says, look at your own life and all the qualities that you are, God's working in you and changing you. That's proof that you have been changed by the gospel, and it's proof that the gospel is true. The gospel that we taught you is true. So the second thing is found in verses 16. So he says, what about another? He says, if that's not enough proof, I'll give you some more proof. Look at verses 16 through 18. He says, for we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to what he says. But we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For verse 17, for when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, and this is what it said, this is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased, we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. Now, Peter's talking about a time where Peter, James, and John were with Jesus when Jesus was turned into his heavenly His heavenly being, and God from heaven said, this is my Son, who I am well pleased. God affirmed that Jesus was truly the Son of God. And so Peter says, not only do we have the testimony, the witness of the fact that you've been changed by the gospel, he says, I've watched it, I've seen it with my own eyes. This Jesus is who he says he is. He really is the Son of God who took away the sins of the world and is coming back to establish his kingdom as God. He really is who he says he is. He said, not only have you experienced it through being saved and the transformation of the gospel, but he gives this second witness and this second testimony, and he says, here's another proof. The fact that I saw it with my very eyes, I heard it with my very ears. This is the Jesus that the Bible is that the Old Testament talked about. This is the Jesus this is the Jesus that is the center and foundation of the gospel. He is legitimate, and God affirmed that. I was there when it happened. So you have this other testimony, and so then you get into verses 19 through 21. So we have the testimony of a changed life. We have the testimony of an eyewitness. Peter was there when it happened. And lastly, look at the last testimony we have. We find it in verses 19 through 21. Peter says, and lastly, we have the prophetic word, more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. He says the last witness, the third witness, is we have proof because of Scripture. We have proof that this gospel is the true gospel because of Scripture. Look at verses, and when he says, and we have the prophetic word. So through the Old Testament, Peter says the Old Testament was proclaiming that this Jesus was the Messiah, that he would be the one that came and took away the sins of the world, that this was the one that the prophets spoke about from all the way back in Genesis, all the way back in the beginning, that there would be one who would come that would destroy Satan's head and would be crowned as the victor and would bring salvation. He says that is the Jesus that even the Old Testament was talking about. And he said, and just so you know, that it wasn't any man-made thing. He said the Holy Spirit spoke and moved through these prophets as they proclaimed that Jesus was coming, that the Messiah was coming. And he says no man could have done this, that it wasn't in man's effort, but it was through the power of the Holy Spirit. So he gives us three testimonies. He says, you want to know that the gospel is true? There's a testimony of your changed life. That is proof that that the gospel is true and that there isn't another gospel. There isn't this other teaching of Jesus. There isn't this secret other stuff out there. He said, what we taught you is true. You want to know why? Number one, you've been changed by it. You know firsthand that the gospel we presented to you is true because it's changed your life. Number two, Peter says, I was an eyewitness to it. I know that this is the Jesus that is prophesied about. This Jesus, man, he was exactly who he said he was. And then lastly, he says the testimony of Scripture. He says the fact that all the Old Testament points to Jesus. All these three testimonies right here, these witnesses, these three proofs should be enough for you not to fall into false teaching, right? Don't fall into false teaching. Don't fall away from the gospel we told you. And so you may think, well, why does Peter use three proofs here? You go to Matthew 18, and all throughout the Bible, the Bible says you must go with three forms of testimony. If you're ever to go to somebody and to correct somebody or to keep some, or to take someone off the wrong path to the right path, you should go with three witnesses. And so that's all throughout Scripture. So what does Peter do? He gives us three witnesses, three testimonies, and says these are three reasons that you should not stray from the gospel. And he gives us three testimonies, which is what everyone did in that time. And so it's just a cool way of understanding that. So with some practical application, I just want to encourage you with this. Remember the gospel that's changed your life. Don't stray from it. Don't add to it. Remember how Jesus has saved you through his work on the cross. And I want to encourage you to share that with other people. And so I'm glad that you tuned in today, and we love every time that you're with us. And each day we are encouraged by the Word of God. Each week we're encouraged that we are to be found faithful. Don't stray from the truth of the gospel. You stand firm in it and advance it at all costs. Thank you for being with us today, and we'll see you next week.